Right, quick background why I'm dressed like this, okay? I'm what's called a living historian. Right, what that is, you study a particular time in history, and what you do is you then buy all the kit, dress up and live it. That's basically it. Okay? But you do it to the extent you then start learning about the personal lives of the soldiers and what they all did, okay? I specialise in various different wars, First World War, Second World War, and the Vietnam War as well. So I've got loads of gear. This is just my First World War stuff. Okay. What we're going to do in the next hour is basically talk about the evolution of the British soldier from 1914 to 1918, how he changed. Okay? And also a bit about what his life was like during that time period. And we'll get rid of some myths that some people have got about the First World War as well. So, this is a standard uniform that I'm wearing, some service dress. Well, you know we wear a two dress. Yeah, no two dress? No, you know what two dress is? Yeah?
Yeah.
Right. Two dress is modelled on this. Right? If you look at two dress and put it next to this, you can see very lot of similarities towards it. Okay? So in 1914, when we first went to war, we're the most technologically advanced soldier on the European theatre of war. Why is that? Does anyone know why? Right. A, we wear a camouflage uniform. Okay, this is called khaki, which is Urdu for dust colour. So we've got a camouflage uniform. The Germans are wearing like a field grey sort of colour. The French are wearing dark blue tunics, bright red trousers. Why, I don't know, because that's French or something. The webbing as well. All the European countries involved in the war were all using leather webbing. What's the problem with using leather webbing? Yeah. But it can dull down, but it wears though, doesn't it? So if it gets wet, used a lot, it starts to crack. Yeah, it soaks in the water as well. So it's not a very practical thing to have. But the British Army have been using leather webbing for hundreds of years. But by 1908, they then devised this, the 1908 pattern webbing. Okay. It's all been properly designed. It's in what's called a figure of eight formation because of the way the straps were designed. Okay, this is called full marching order. So you've got a large pack, which is on the back, that's got a big coat in it called a great coat. Then the small bag is your personal effects bag, alright, your small pack. Then you've got what today we call mess tins, but in the First World War we'd be calling Dixies. Okay, then you've got two pouches with ammunition. Ignore the knife, that's just an add-on. Okay. You've got a water bottle that holds just over a pint of water, I think it's about a pint and a half, 2 pints. You've got a trenching tool, okay, that's like a pickaxe. And on the side you've got your bayonet and the helm for the entrenching tool. This all weighs about 65 pounds. Right, do you want to quickly hold it, see how heavy it actually is. Got it around the back, put your hand down, don't fall over. That's about 75 pounds worth of kit. A British soldier at this time period could march for 25 miles a day wearing this kit. I'm going to put it on, demonstrate. So, our British soldier in 1914, he's got a camouflage uniform, he's got the most high-tech webbing as well. Has the British soldier at this time got going for him? What do you think?
Advanced
weaponry. Yeah, you've got quite a good weaponry. The Enfield rifle's one of the best rifles on the battlefield. If I think the best rifle on the battlefield because of the advantages it has, which we'll go into in a moment. Yeah.
Haven't they also got lice?
Sorry?
They've also got lice, haven't they?
Yeah, that comes a bit later when we're doing trench warfare. What else they've got for them is that they're very disciplined troops. Okay, because punishment's quite harsh in the army at this time. So it's something called field punishment number one. You know what that might be? Field punishment number one? No.
Is it like the wheat thing?
No, it's flogging. That went out in the 1840s. That did.
In the trenches, if you turn back, you got shot.
Yeah, that's one of the punishments you can get, being shot for desertion. Field punishment number one is what happens is they strip you down to your waist and they tie you up to a gun carriage for 48 hours. And you're just left there. And you're fed on bread and water. That's field punishment number one. The other punishment as well is that you have all this kit on. So you're wearing a 75-pound kit, plus you've got your rifle as well, your SMLE, which weighs about 9 pounds, and you have to run around parade square like that, above your head. And you do that until the proper sergeant will tell you to stop. There's quite a lot of men who die from the exhaustion, so that's why the army don't do it anymore, because they were still doing this way into like the 70s. They were. So, as I look now, it's how the British soldier looked in 1914. Right, these are bandoliers. Okay, you've got 50 rounds in here. Yeah, 50 rounds. No helmet yet. Okay, British soldier, we don't have helmets yet. Helmets aren't going to come into the war until 1916. So the first soldiers to go and fight the Germans in 1914 looked exactly as I look now. Okay? So, infield rifle. What's the advantages to it? The round itself is 303, which is one of them. The round can travel for over a mile. Okay, it's a really powerful round. And also the bolt, it's got a curved bolt on it. Most of the European weapons at this time are using what's called a huntsman's action. What I mean by huntsman's action is the bolt is straight. So it just comes straight out like that. So when you cock it, you've got to literally lift it up, pull it back, forward, down. This you don't, it just comes up to the side and back down again. But by having this configuration, is if I'm shooting at somebody, I can actually follow my target. So I can follow him, miss him, but I can still follow him and shoot him at the same time. With the German French rifles, with the huntsman's action, I have to shoot him, take my off the target, pull the bolt back, bring it forward, back down and try and find him again. So this is why this is a very superior rifle, and even today it's still used by the Indian police. They're still using these. And soldiers in Afghan have been finding these in weapons caches used by the Taliban as well, from the times when we fought in Afghan border, in what is now Pakistan, as part of India. That was all Indian frontier territory, so it's all from that time. The other thing as well, the British soldier with this rifle, he could fire over about 50 rounds a minute with this rifle. Right, it was called the Mad Minute. What he did was, not using your trigger finger, he'd use his middle finger. Okay, so when he's firing, he's not aiming. He is aiming, but he isn't. His way is he's just put down a lot of fire. So at normal rate of fire, you're looking at about 35 rounds a minute. But with the Mad Minute, you're snapping it. So you're getting off over nearly maybe 60 rounds a minute. I'm going to demonstrate that to you now. I haven't done this for a very long time, so I might cock it up. Hey, what timer of them? Timer on your phone?
6:51.
Got one.
You've got a timer.
Yeah. Oh,
I
have a
timer. Oh, whoops. Like a stopwatch,
yeah?
Yeah. Move these round. Make sure these are the right ones. Yeah, those are the right ones. Right. So, when we start, count 10 rounds in a magazine, okay? So you have 10 rounds in a magazine, got 5 rounds in a stripper clip, okay? Alright, what's going on here? You can see they're not designed to go back in like this, they'll just be thrown on the ground, the stripper clips. Never going to be seen again. Right, okay. So imagine we've got the magazine.